When I first arrived in 96, not the first time, the second time, when I came here to live here, I decided, I arrived and I was working and there were no gyms, there was no fitness, and like no knowledge.
In 96.
Yeah, so I had my certification already. So I taught at a gym, and that's where I think I met Joe the first time, was at the gym.
Huh.
Yeah, because I was teaching fitness, and I would just leave after work, and it was always in a hotel at that time.
What did you teach?
I taught aerobics, and step aerobics, yeah.
Wow.
So I taught after work, and I would meet tons of people that way, but it would force me to leave the office, because otherwise I would be in there all the time. So, and especially in the agency, right? We're always working, so it forced me to leave at 7, because my class started at 7, so I used to teach like 3 times a week. And I would, you know, teach other Vietnamese how to teach, and teach them how a little bit more about what fitness was about, you know, the lifestyle of fitness and health, healthy living. So I've always done it. And in 97 I started to do yoga, and I was not teaching yoga, but I was teaching fitness. So I've always been doing lots of fitness and lots of health things. The fitness and health things were always my passion.
So it's always been calling you one way or another.
Yeah, and I did it for free. So my whole thing was, why would I make the money? So why don't I just do this and I just offer it because I can? And because it was so non-existent, like there was no personal trainers, people had no knowledge of like weight training, cardio, nothing. There was no knowledge. So, you know, being one of the first people here was really, it was important. I felt like it was important to be able to share the information I had and for people to benefit. So, you know, there were some Vietnamese that they were just in the hotel, they were like reception at the gym. Now they're teaching, they're doing great.
Oh.
Yeah. So I've always been doing it. And yeah, so when I took the 6 years off, I thought about what I really wanted to do as the next thing. You know, I have all these like different hats and different skill sets, but then what is it that I really wanted to do? And how it started was I was just getting asked to do 10 workshops and do workshops, and I felt like I was going to these workshops and I started noticing there were much more Vietnamese coming to do yoga and to do all different kinds of, they were getting more interested in food and more interested in, you know, environmental issues and health issues. And but then even with the foreign community, no one had any access to information like where, how, you know, where do I find information?
So you took the leadership.
Yeah. But I think the market was right for it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so we're the first wellness center in Vietnam. And we opened
What is a wellness center?
What is a wellness center? I know. Well, it's a platform, actually. It's not just a center, it's a physical center is a part of it, but it's actually a platform.
Uh-huh.
So it's where we can, it's a place where anyone who's practicing wellness, are fairly broad.
What is wellness anyway?
Right? So wellness, the definition of wellness is that you need to put an effort in. It's not just like, it just comes from the sky. Like you need to put in the effort to feel better about yourself.
Right.
Whether it's
exercise.
Yeah, physically, mentally, spiritually. Right. So because all those three things creates a sense of well-being.
Mm-hmm.
So it is very broad.
So
but
this
is
the place that people come here to attend this week.
Yeah. So it's a place. The platform is basically where practitioners, like people who are teaching or have professions in the wellness industry, they, you know, because prior to having a platform, everyone was working on their own at home, like without any professional like place. Mm-hmm. Everyone was, you know, in by themselves, or maybe a few of them knew each other, of course, but you know, there was no professional place where everyone could meet and work together. So one part of it is for all practitioners to be able to meet and connect with each other, and then so that they're not just working alone.
How big is this community?
It's quite big. It's growing. I mean, initially when we started, I always knew that there were a few osteopaths.
Mm-hmm.
Like just to give you an example, like osteopathy, there was a French osteopath that was here 2006. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
He was here in 2006. But I think he was here a little too early.
Right.
I remember meeting him And yeah, people just didn't really have an idea what that was. And they were not so open to trying. And yeah, I think he was here for several years and then he went back. And then there was nothing that I really, other than acupuncture, I mean, traditional medicine existed in Vietnam, has always existed in Vietnam, but, you know, Asian culture is quite common. So there has been, like, there are Vietnamese, you know, centers, like, you know, healing centers, mostly with acupuncture and things like that. But the challenge for, particularly foreigners, is language. There's no one that speaks English. Second, there was concern around hygiene. You know, what's, especially if you're doing acupuncture. I mean, I've done acupuncture here in Vietnam in the years that, you know, the years that I've been here. But yeah, I mean, you're never, I mean, they give you a set of needles, and they give you a metal box, and they keep your needles in the box with your, you know, name on it, right?
Scary.
Yeah, for some people, it can be kind of, you know, not settling to know that, you know.
So, you make it sound like it's such a natural progression.
Yeah.
Have there been challenges, you know, doing this?
No, not really. I mean, no, it's been, I mean, this is my second business that I've started up.
So, a lot of experiences.
Yeah, I mean, the other business that I had it for over 10 years.
Of course so.
So, and at a very much more difficult period of time too.
Comparing to the scale, this is...
One, and at that time, you know, there was such little talent, there was such... I mean, the market was so different too. You know, people that we were hiring in the agency, when I was working in the agency, I mean, they were, as long as they could speak some English, they didn't have any computer skills, they had no idea about advertising, they had no idea about the products we were selling, you know, as clients. They never heard about any of it. They never heard about advertising. So, you know, in the night, my job then was, as long as you can speak some English and you are willing to learn and work hard, train them. And then out of that, after when I left the agency and I started with the interior design and architecture, same thing. Very few, there's an architecture university, but the architecture they were doing at that time, they were not thinking of interior design and architecture in the same way. So, I mean, it was very challenging, also very, a creative industry, very, very challenging to develop creativity.
So it sounds like you've always been a teacher at heart.
Well, I think just doing all this and just building up that skill set of, yeah, this is the type of market where you kind of constantly, but this has been different because there has been less, yes, there's education, like the market needs education. But yeah, the teaching part, with fitness, yes, that's always been there because that was always new when I first arrived. So yes, there. But that market's kind of like that. You need to, one, be adventurous. Second, understand that, you know, that you need to be patient and be able to give people the information and showing people what you think. And they're quite open. They're very open to learning. Yeah, I mean, people that arrived around the same time I did. I mean, I would say everyone is an entrepreneur. I mean, I don't think if you were just working for a company that you would stay here that long.
Right.
Yeah, I think most people who are here 15, 20, 30 years, you need...
They're solving a problem, they're contributing more.
Yeah, rather than just being a soldier in the... Yeah. I think that's what keeps you here, I guess, is just knowing that there's, you can contribute, you can give back. But yeah, I mean, when I decided I wanted to do this, I thought, you know, I've been in the health and fitness industry for a long time here, and I wanted to, again, make a difference in that. And I thought the timing was good to be able to broaden it and give people a much more clear, precise place. Like, you know, even if we don't offer it, at least we have contact or we might have an idea of where some of that information is.
So this center, Mandela,
is
a place where people come, trainers or practitioners come to sharpen themselves.
Yeah, usually when they come, like usually when people, I mean, most of the practitioners are not Vietnamese. Most of the modalities, like therapies, they don't exist in Vietnam. So they're new.
Right.
But they've somehow, practitioners have arrived for whatever various reasons, they've come to Vietnam. And so they somehow find us either through word of mouth or through the internet, through the website or whatever, they've been researching and they find us. But they always come and find us.
It's like a hub.
Yeah, so they, so we've created that thing where we keep, at least keep contact, we kind of know who they are.
But do end users, or do people come in to practice yoga as a normal person?
Yeah, so then the other side of it is, that's on the practitioner side, and then on the end user side, it was the same kind of thing. No one knew where, like, there was no one place where you could find out about, if I wanted, I have this problem, you know, where should I go, or what could I do? I mean, you could go to the standard traditional route, conventional route, go to the doctor, you know, go get a scan, get some tests done, blah, 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 that stuff. Of course, you can do that.
Mm-hmm.
But there, you know, what there was a sense of is that people are looking for more than that.
Would you call yourself the alternative medical
medicine
provider?
Yeah, I mean, that's part of the wellness too.
Right.
Yeah, all the things that you can't find in conventional.
This room that we're sitting in,
you
told me that it's a hypnotherapy room.
Hypnotherapy,
as well as psychotherapy.
Yeah, that's what this room is generally used for.
Right.
Yeah.
That's why it feels so calm, the energy.
I mean, each of the rooms are somewhat different, and it's a big place.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, this was an epic because of the ceilings. We couldn't do yoga in here, and it was more quieter up here. Compared to if you're on the next level down because of the different classes and activities on the main floor.
What I'm thinking as I was asking this is, it almost feel like, you know, it's a very holistic hospital, or, you know, a place that whatever problem there is a solution for within this.
Our motto is empowering from within. So, you know, wellness is not going to come from the sky, it's going to come from yourself.
Right.
I mean, if you want to make a change, whatever the issues are, like if you're feeling discomfort or whatever issues, you've got to make the effort, either make the effort to come and seek something, or once you seek something, to actually follow through and meet somebody or do something, like whatever it is. It might be fitness oriented, it might be mentally oriented, it might be spiritual, whatever it may be, you got to do it yourself. No one can do that for you.